This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning, everyone. So in the last class, we have seen the concept of element binding, which is dependent on binding context and binding context path. So it's a very powerful binding that we have in SAP UI5. Generally, you can't find this type of binding in any other technology. Okay. So binding wise, whatever SAP UI5 offers, so that kind of bindings, the other technologies, you don't find these powerful bindings in other technologies, right? So what we are going to see in today's class is, we are going to see how to search, that is how to filter this data and how to sort this data basing on some column. Okay. So however, for JSON data, you just need to use some libraries. And in case of the data that is coming from backend, the code that you write from the front end will not change, but you also need to write the code in the backend, then only the sorting and filtering will happen. Otherwise, it won't happen. But in case of JSON data, since it is a hard-coded data, so it automatically, whatever with the code that you are going to write now, so it automatically sort and filter with the provided libraries itself. But in case of OData, it just send this sorting and filtering information to the backend, and the real filtering and sorting will happen from the backend. Okay. However, you should know both. Okay. Right. So what I am going to do, I'm going to create a search field here and two buttons here, one for sort ascending, one for sort descending. Okay. So this area is called table header. Sorry, this area is called list header or table header. Anyway, both are same. Okay. So this area, whatever the area that where you can see this heading. Okay. So if you want to create a search field, you need to create this search field in the header area. Okay. So which we will write after the list tag, we need to write here header toolbar, and inside, so you need to create something called toolbar, and here you need to create your search field. Okay. So before we write the search field, the moment you write your own, you write your header toolbar, the header text that is already present in this header toolbar will be gone because you are overriding it. So you need to write this header text once again here. Did you understand what I said? This will not have any impact now because you are creating your header toolbar the way you want. Okay. If you are not writing this, then header text will simply give some header text at this particular area. But if you are writing your own header toolbar, then this will not have any impact. You need to create one more. Okay. So even though you write this, even though you don't write this, it doesn't have any impact. Okay. So you need to create your header text here. So text equal to as badge 44 students. Okay. And you already have the CSS class for SAPM H3 font size. Okay. Right. So you will get the same output as that of the previous. Now I am creating a search field. Okay, so search field. This is how you can create the search field. The search field also, you know, just like input field, it will occupy the entire area. So let us give some width here. Width equal to 30%. Now let us see the output at this moment. Now you can see the search field has appeared, but it looks nice if the search field go to the end of the line instead of here. So this is coming just after your heading. So normally in the real time, we keep this search field at the end of the line. So how can you do that? In the header toolbar, it provides something called toolbar spacer. So what the spacer will do, the spacer simply push the UI element to the end of the line. Okay, so I am creating a toolbar spacer here. This is called toolbar spacer. So what this spacer will do, it comes in middle of the text UI element and search UI element, and it simply push the search field to the end of the line. Okay, so we can save and refresh to see. Got it? Right. So we'll create two more buttons, one for sort ascending and another for sort descending also. So button, let's keep the icon equal to sepi-icon:. Sort ascending ascending. Okay, so this is one button for sort ascending, and this is another button for sort descending. Okay, right. So these are two buttons. Now let us see. So you got sort ascending and sort descending, right? So now what we need to do is we need to understand how can we filter the data. So searching is nothing but filtering. So how can we filter the data and sort the data? Filtering and sorting. So SAP UI5 has provided two libraries, one for filter and another for sort. You just need to create the object and the parameters you need to pass according to the library, and that's it. And you need to apply that filter object and sorter object on the list of items. That's it. Okay, so very simple and easy. So what is the filter library SAP UI5 is providing? SAP.UI.model.filter. And it is also providing another object called filter operator. So these two SAP UI5 is providing for filtering. And for sorting, SAP.UI.model.sorter. So this is the library which SAP UI5 is providing for sorting. Now, if you want to filter or sort, you need to create an object of filter. If you want to filter, and you have to create an object of sorter if you want to sort the data. Okay, now let us see the syntax of filter object and let us see the syntax of sorter object. One second. Yeah, I'm back. Right. So let us see how to create the object of sorter and how to create the object of filter. Okay. So let us start with the filter. So you need to define an object of the filter equal to new. This entire thing, new filter. So this will create an object of the filter. Okay. So similarly, to create the sorter, you need to write object sorter. If you observe, I am following the naming convention of SAP UI 5. Every object will start with O. New sap.ui.model.sorter. Okay. Now these two libraries will accept some parameters. So what are those parameters? The filter will accept three parameters. The first one is the column name on which you want to filter the data. Okay, so in our case, let us filter the data on employee name. Okay, the second parameter is the filter operator. So which gives you the flexibility, how do you want to filter? Okay, so you want to filter out the employees whose name starts with, ends with, or contains a single letter, okay, or equal to something, not equal to something. Okay, so it gives you that enough flexibility. So that is filter operator is the second object. Okay, and third is the value that you typed in the search field. Okay, so because with this value, it has to compare and do the filtering. For example, I typed A. Okay, otherwise AB. I typed AB. Then I want all the employees whose name contains AB, for example. So if you see Abhinay is containing AB. Okay, and none other. Right, so only Abhinay should get filtered because Abhinay contains AB. For example, I want to search in such a way like whose name starts with AB. Then again, Abhinay. Okay. So, for example, I have written, I typed N. I want all the people who has N, who contains N in their employee name. So, Abhinay, Anil, Nag, Ranjit. So all these people should be filtered out. Okay. So that is basically the filter operator. How do you want to filter? If it is contains, you want to filter, or it should starts with, ends with, equal to, not equal to, what it is. So that decides the filter operator. And value is the value that you typed in the search field here. Okay. So that is a value. Now let's go ahead and write the code for searching, that is filtering and sorting. Right. So when do you want to search the trigger? The moment I type even a single letter in the search field, I want to trigger my filter. So typing even a single letter in the search field is an action performed by the end user. So the action name is live change. Okay, so live change is the action that triggers the moment you type even a single letter in the search field. Understood? When the end user type even a single letter in the search field, this particular live change action will trigger. So let us assign a function on search employee. Okay, so copy this, go to its controller. So let me write here. Okay, on such employee, and the O event concept will be there here also. So variable, the first thing you need to do is read out the value that he has typed in the search field. So value equals to, so I want to read what is the value that he has typed in the search field, so that you can read it by oevent.get parameter, and the parameter name is new value. So this statement will return you whatever the value that you entered in the search field. Okay, so after that you need to declare a array here. So why you need to declare, you will understand in a couple of minutes. Just wait. Now I'm writing a if condition. I just want to check whether the user really typed something or not. Okay. So if value not equals to empty, then only I want to filter. Otherwise, I don't want to filter. Why should I create filter unnecessarily? I will create filter only if the value is not equal to empty. Okay. To create filter unsorter, you need to load the libraries at the top, SAP/UI/model/filter. This is the first SAP.UI.model.filter. Yeah, that's correct. And copy this one more time, filter operator, and one more time for sorter. Okay, SAP.UI.model.sorter. Now define the shortcut names. This is filter operator. And this is sorter. Okay, so you have defined all the libraries. Now come down to create the filter object. So if the value is not equal to empty, that means end user has entered some data. Now you create your filter. So variable object filter equals to new filter, and it accepts three arguments as we discussed. So one is the column on which you want to filter, second one filter operator, third one value. So first one, the column on which you want to filter, go to the model data.json. So out of these many properties, I want to filter the data basing on employee name. So write employee name, comma. You need to write the operator, filter operator dot for example, let us take contains. So because in real time we use contains operator a lot. Contains comma. Now the third parameter is the value that he typed. Okay, right, your filter is ready. So this filter will work only as per the syntax. You need to keep this filter in the array, then only it will work. So that's why I have declared this particular filter. Okay, so let's keep this filter inside the array. So array dot push. So push is a function which we use to keep something inside the array. Okay, so array dot push. So what you need to push? You need to push this object. Okay. Right. So now you created a filter and you successfully pushed that into the array. Okay. Right. So the only thing that was pending is you need to apply this filter on the list of items. So for that, you need to get the items. To get the items of the list, so let us declare an ID for the list. Okay. So I declared the ID for the list, ID list. So as per the naming convention, you need to write ID list employee. Okay, you need to write the purpose also. Now point out to the list by writing this dot get view dot by ID. So ID list employee. So you are pointing out to the list dot get binding items. Okay, so you are getting the items of the list dot filter. You are filtering the items of the list, but you need to pass this particular filter. Okay, then only the items get filtered automatically. Okay, so here this filter object will accept only array. So that's why we have declared the array and push our filter object into the array. Okay, so I'm repeating once again, this dot get view by ID. So list of employees dot get binding items. So items of this list dot filter means filter these items with this array of filters. Okay, so now inside this you have employee name contains value. So whatever the letter or letters that you have typed, so with those letters, whatever the employees contains these letters, they will be filtered out. Okay, so let us see the output. Now I'm typing some letter, all of you observe, I'm typing N. Okay, so Abhinay should be there, Anil should be there, Lalit will not be there, Nag will be there, Ranjit will be there, Shiva will not be there. Okay, so I'm typing N. So you can see Abhinay there, Anil there, Nag there, Ranjit there, only four. Okay, the rest of the people filtered out. Okay, so again from N, I'm typing N. Yeah, okay. So when I type NA, Abhinay will be there, Nag will be there, Anil and Ranjit will be out. Okay. See, I typed NA, you can see Abhinay and Nag, the remaining people filtered out. Okay. So again, if I type G, only Nag will be there. So you can click the item to go to the next page. Understand? And if you click cancel button, that is coming. So all the items will be reloaded again. Okay. So for example, I type AN, Anil and Ranjit again. And if I click this cancel reset button, so everything will be reset. Understood? So in case of OData, if the data is coming from the backend, then this coding part will not change. Only in place of employee name, you will keep the OData field. So whatever the OData field that you declared, so you will keep this one. And what this particular filter will do, so it will send this particular column name, operator and value to the backend, and there the real filtering will happen. So in case of JSON, that is not required. In case of OData, so this particular coding, what it does, it sends the data to the backend, and there you will collect this column name, this operator and value, and then you will filter out, you will write the filter logic in the backend. Understand? So anyway, that you will see once we are going to start OData in a couple of days. Okay, so then you will understand. Now let us write the logic of sorting, sort ascending and sort descending. So it is very easy. The sorter, in order to sort the list of items, so you need to depend on the library called sorter. The sorter takes only two parameters. One is column name. So in my case, I want to filter the data, sorry, sort the data based on employee name. And second parameter is true or false, stands for ascending order or descending order. I want to sort the data employee name ascending order, then it is False. If you want to sort the data on employee name with a descending order, then the second parameter is true. Okay, so that is the only difference. Okay, so let us implement the logic for the sorter now. So sorting is very easy. I am repeating once again. So for sorting, you need to create an object of the sorter, and it takes only two parameters. One is the column name on which you want to sort. The second one is whether you want to have ascending order or descending order. False for the ascending order, true for the descending order. That's it. Now go to the view and assign two functions, one for ascending order, one for descending order buttons. So press equal to sort ascending. And here also you need to assign one more function, press equal to sort descending. Okay. So let us implement the functions here. So this is the sort ascending function, and similarly you can copy paste this for sort descending. DESC. Okay, right. Now to sort ascending, so as we discussed, you need to create an object of the sorter. Object sorter equals to new sorter. And what are the parameters it takes? It takes only two parameters. Column name. So in our case, the column name is employee name. Sorry. Okay, and second parameter, if it is ascending order, the parameter is false, and if it is descending order, the parameter is true. Okay, so you are ready with the sorter objects, and again you need to apply this particular sorting on the list of items. So again, point to the list by using get binding items, get the items. Okay, dot, in place of filter you need to write sort. Okay, and then you can pass this sorter object in the round brackets. Okay, the data will automatically sort it as per the parameters that you have passed. Okay, so similarly copy this, paste here. That's it. So again, you created the sorter object, and you are sorting the list of items by using sort predefined function, and you are passing the sorter object here. That's it. The data will get sorted in the ascending and descending order. So only two lines of code you need to write to sort. And you need to write some four to five lines of code for filtering. Save this and refresh your screen. So filtering we already seen, now sorting. I think unfortunately we already have this in sorting order, I guess. Yeah. See, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R. Yes, the data is already there in the sorting order. I don't think there is any change. See, there is no change. But anyway, descending order, we can check. So Shiva should come on the top. Yeah, so Shiva has came to the top. And then Ranjit, Nag, and Abhinay will go to the bottom. So now you can test with the sort ascending. So if you click again, so Abhinay should come to the top. So you can see Abhinay has came to the top. Okay. So that's how you need to, you know, do the sorting and filtering. So with the JSON model. Now what I am going to do, I am going to replace my list with a table. Okay, so this is the list. I'm going to replace this list with a table. And without changing much code, without changing any other code, whatever the actions, whatever the events that we have written for the list, the same events will be there for the table also. Table and list both are derived from the same library. Okay, so the parent library for list and table both are same. So the actions, everything will be same. So you no need to write, if I in real time, either you use list or table, any one of them. So depending on the client. So what I'm saying is, whatever the actions that you have used so far, all the actions are same even for the table. Okay, so it's enough if you simply replace this particular list code in the view with a table code. That's it. You no need to write the controller coding, because the controller coding you have already written for the list. Since the actions are same even for list and table, so those you can reutilize. Okay, so let us see how we can replace this with a table. So as I told you, table and list both are derived from the same parent library. The only difference is the list does not contain columns, but a table shows columns as well. Okay, so I'm commenting out this particular list and writing table. So all of you observe, this is table code. Okay, you can put the same properties of the table, copy and paste. Okay, and even the header toolbar is there for the table also, so you can copy and paste. Okay, and for a list you have object list item, but in case of table you have column list item, column list item. But before you create your column list item, you need to create the table columns. So this is the only difference between a table and list. Okay, so in list you have object list item to be defined. In case of table you have column list item to be defined. But in addition, table will also have the columns of the table. Okay, so let us define the columns. So this is the columns tag inside which you need to define the columns. So column, and this for you need to write the text of the column. So I'm writing employee ID. Copy this, paste as many columns as you want. Employee name, designation, employee skill, employee location. I'm keeping only 5 columns, right? So once the columns definition is over, we can start writing the column list item. Okay, so just like the way you have written object list item, so similarly you can write column list item. So the column list item will be written inside something called items and cells. So items are nothing but the rows of your table. Cells, so what is cells? In every row, whatever the data that you are keeping, so that you will keep in a cell actually. Okay, so let me open the diagram. So let's say this is your table. These are the columns that we have defined just now. Okay, so we defined some 5 columns. Okay, now items stands for the rows of the table. So this is the row. And what is cells? In every row, you will keep the data in a cell. So this is one cell. This is another cell. This is another cell. This is another cell. And this is another cell. So that is what is cell. Okay. So inside the cell, the data will go and sit. And so you need to provide the values for each and every column in the same order. So what is my first column? Employee ID. So you need to provide the value for that. So you just need to bind with the corresponding property. So what is the corresponding property? Employee ID. Just bind it. So you are binding the value for this column. So this is the column and you are binding the value for this column. Control C, Control V, Control V, Control V, and Control V 5 times. So here you need to write column list item. You have not written. Yeah. That's why it is showing error. So here items stands for the rows of the table. Column list item stands for one row, each row. So you are constructing the each row by using column list item. Okay. So just like object list item is one item of the list, column list item is one row of the table. And when you are constructing the row, you are creating cells in that particular row, and then you are defining the values for that particular row. Employee name, designation. What is this? Skill. And this is location. That's it. So with this, the table is over. I will just tell you what happens at runtime. The moment the table binding items equal to pointing to the array, the table starts acting like a loop. Okay. However, this particular columns will be executed only once. It will not be executed multiple times. So only the columns portion will be executed once. So the columns will be created in the beginning. After that only, this particular items array of employees will start working like a loop. So the moment it started working like a loop, it pickups the first row from this particular array and immediately it goes here. Items means the rows of the table, and you can see column list item here. The column list item is nothing but one row of the table is called column list item. And it start constructing this particular row, so like this. And by looking at the tag cells, it keeps the cells in all the columns. Okay, so it keeps the cells. And so these are the values that it is keeping in each and every cell. Okay. So employee ID, employee name, designation. So employee ID is pointing to 100001. So under this particular column, 100001 will go and sit. Okay. So similarly, employee name, similarly, employee designation, similarly, skill, similarly, location. And again, the loop gets repeated. So it is pointing to the second one. Again, it comes to the items. Again, column list item means second row. Second row gets constructed. And in the second row, it keeps cells. And inside the cells, it is keeping the values. Now let us see the output. Got it? This is the table. And whatever the actions for the list, the same actions will applicable for the table also. Click on any row, you'll go to the second page. So that still works. And type something here. For example, AN, see, the data is filtering. Why? Because the same events applicable for list and table. So since you already written and you are using the same functions, it is still working. So click cancel, fine. So sorting and ascending, sort descending will also work. So ascending does not have effect because we already have in the ascending order. So click descending, it's working, and click ascending. Okay, so you can see the order has changed. Okay, so that is the table and list and how you need to work the table and list with the JSON model. Understand? Right. So that's it for today's class. Answer to Lalit's question, yes, it is pure JavaScript, which is provided by SAP UI5. It is not the JavaScript that you normally find it in the open source, outside in web technology, whatever the JavaScript that you use, that is not this JavaScript. Okay, so that's what I told you in the beginning. Even though you know JavaScript, even though you don't know JavaScript, it does not have any impact on you. Okay, so let's say I know JavaScript, but whatever the JavaScript that we are using here, that JavaScript is not having no comparison. So with the JavaScript that you normally learn outside, the people teach outside, right? So that JavaScript is not this JavaScript. So we don't use answer to Lalit question again. So we don't use jQuery. We don't use any Angular script here. See, simple, only one point. SAP has rewritten the complete API for SAP UI5. So we'll be using only that. And SAP strongly recommend not to use any other JavaScript in SAP UI5. Okay. And those will not work at all. So he is removing all that, things. So once upon a time, it used to a little bit support. See, SAP is a product. It is not an open source.
This one, I have a question. Hello?
Please.
Yeah, in the first view, we have declared as a true or false, right? In the first controller for that list view.
Okay, true or yeah. False? I didn't. Can you show what you are telling?
No, in the list.
Okay.
Yeah, in place of that, can we declare this boolean?
Where? Can you show? That's what I'm saying. Can you show and tell me?
In the controller, I think so.
Okay.
Yeah, this one.
This one you are saying.
Yeah.
See here, what is the meaning of this one? The second column meaning is the sorter accepts two parameters. The first parameter is the column name on which you want to sort. The second parameter is how you want to sort, whether ascending order or descending order. Okay. False stands for ascending order. True stands for descending order. Okay, so this is how the API has given. Okay, so that is the meaning actually. We need to understand the parameter meaning over there and we need to use it accordingly.
Okay, fine, yeah.
Sir, if you want more than one column, so you have to rewrite all this code. You want to sort on more than one column?
Yes, you need to. Okay. Actually, sorting normally happens only on one column, but filtering can be done on multiple columns. Okay, because even you sort basing on multiple columns also. So definitely, when you sort on multiple columns, again all the columns data will change. Right. So for example, I have price and I have name. When you are sorting on name. And if you are sorting on name column, we'll definitely rearrange all the columns according to the ascending and descending. And if you are sorting on, for example, on price, okay, on descending order, for example, so that order will change. So in general, sorting will be performed only on single column, but filtering, yes, we can perform on multiple columns. Okay.
Does we use any Excel for this data? Does we use importing and exporting? Back there is importing and export, like download and upload is there. The internal data will fetch into the Excel whenever it is uploaded. Whenever it's downloaded, again the Excel data will fetch into the internal table and it will be stored in the SAP database table.
Yeah, that is you know, your backend, so it supports you, that is a see, that is a server, right? So that supports, but in general, so you don't do that from UI5. So UI5 is to pull your backend data into the front end and do some processing or whatever you want, like CRUD operations. Okay, so edit, you know, perform multiple operations, and then again send the data back to the SAP. Okay, like, you know, approve, rejecting, or any creation of creation, updation on custom tables, or for example, I want to create a purchase order. So these kind of things from the front end.
Okay.
So you have one last topic with the JSON model, and that is developing F4 help. So most of the people know what is F4 help dialog. Okay, so needless to explain. So tomorrow we are going to develop that particular F4 help. Or so why it is called as basically F4 help? When you click on F4, so the pop-up dialog will open and it will show the some suggestions or whatever the data. Okay, so that we'll see in tomorrow's class, and then from day after tomorrow,
how to debug the, is there any debugging in this JavaScript?
Yes, we have debugging in JavaScript, so which we show in a separate class. Okay, so once the OData starts, we'll show in the next class. One second. Yeah, so we have a separate class on debugging. Yes, we'll show. Okay, the debugging almost looks similar as that of your backend only, just like it's more easy than backend. You just need to put the debug point here also, and you can execute line by line. Okay, and we also use the alert statements and console statements also for debugging. Okay, so which you already aware. Okay,
hello.
Yes, Ranjit.
Hello. How the debugging it happens? That is from screen elements to OData, OData to backend, again from backend to OData, OData to screen elements. Is that way it is going to happen in debugging mode? That's my question.
Yeah. Yes. The debugging starts from the front end, and front end it goes to the backend actually. Okay, and again from backend it won't come, it won't, so it will show the response also. Okay, but normally in general the debugging will start from UI5 and ends with the backend.
Okay,
you will understand once we show debugging. Okay, so for debugging also you will click F12, and in the F12 window only. So if you are See here, so in the sources, so it loads your controller. You can't debug your view, you can debug only the controllers. Okay, so open whatever the controller you want and just place the debug point, for example. So this is, for example, what is the code that we have written in today's class? Yeah, so sorting, for example, keep this, this is debugger. Just click the button, it's a debugger. Now, if you start, sorting ascending order, see, I'm clicking. See, it has stopped. Okay, it's passed in debugger. And this is line to line execution. This is to go into, into the next function. And this is to come out of the current function. And this is to come out of any predefined function. And this is to deactivate all the debug points. Okay, so in general we use this one, these three we use. Okay, so we don't use this one also. So just click this one, so it goes to the next line. Okay, so it has created the sorter. Now again, if you click this one, so it goes to the next line. Okay, and since two lines has been executed,
can you see here the values? Anywhere.
Yeah, you can see the values also, but these are objects, so object yeah. Values, see, you can see the S path, employee name, so you can see all the values. Let me take one more example. So I will select this one, on select employee. So this is very easy to understand, so that you can see S path, all these values. Okay. Okay, I'm clicking on any one of the row. So the moment you click on the row, this function gets executed, on select employee. Okay, so click this and it has stopped. Now execute one line. Now you can just hover your mouse on the variable. It shows the value. See, slash area of employee slash 3. Okay, so execute one more line. So it has executed. Now see index. Index is 3. So it prints here also. See, index equal to 3. It shows all the variable values here. You can see here, right? Index equal to 3. Okay, so like this, the debugger is very easy. You just need to keep the debug point and execute line to line. Okay, you can give multiple debug points also and click the play button so that it switch from one debug point to another debug point. It stops wherever the another debug point is there. Okay. So it just you just need to keep your mouse on the variable and it shows the value inside the variable. So this is very easy than your debug that you do in backend.
Okay.
Okay, that's it. Nothing much actually. So keep as many debug points you want and just execute line to line and see the. So actually, you know, here, this is more, very easy debugging compared to the backend. It whatever the line that got executed, it simply print the value also here. You don't need to keep your mouse also. See, at line number 48, the line got executed and it is showing index equal to 3 here. So it prints the value there itself. Okay. So you don't need to keep your mouse on the variable also. That is very easy. Okay, so I'm removing the debug point. So it has go to the next view. So all right, guys, I'm sending this code to you and we'll meet in tomorrow's class with the last topic of JSON model, that is developing F4 help.
Okay. Hey Rajwan, this is Prasad.
Yeah,
somehow the class 8 is not opening and also I can't see anything basically. I don't know whether anyone has experienced the same thing or it's only different to me.
Anybody comment on this? He's saying class 8 is not opening for him. But I have double checked it and it is opening. Anybody else can... It's opening. Okay. Prasad, I did not give any special permissions to your ID. So it should open for you also, because I think you already told me on this.
I cannot see, I cannot add to my Google Drive, basically.
Not adding. I have shared it to you.
Uh-huh.
Okay, you just need to play it. I did not understand what you are saying.
See, the thing is, you are sharing to me, okay? I can keep
okay.
a copy into my Google Drive, isn't it? The same thing, whatever you're sending to me, just keep
you,
it.
You see, you will get a link, okay?
Yes, exactly.
And when you click the link, it will take you to that
Google Drive
video. Yeah.
Yeah.
It will
yeah.
take you
but,
to my Google Drive.
Uh-huh.
And then you can watch it.
I think I have a problem with that. I think I sent an email also, right, a couple of times. Only the problem is only 8. The rest I can see it. It's not a problem. Because I'm doing the same thing for 8 also.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not sure, Prasad, why it is happening. But what I can do for you is I can just resend to you. That's it.
Yeah, try it. Maybe I can check it out again. Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
They are saying that it's a 8 video is the layouts part 2 dot mp4. Prasad, right?
Yeah. 8. I know, because Rizwan is sending with the numbers, right?
Yeah.
So 8 is having problem to me.
Just a second. I'm going to check that one.
Yeah, just check if that is creating a problem for everyone then. I will just resend it.